It is considered one of the most important Christian celebrations, and on this occasion we are joined in the studio with Dr. Khaled Al-Bayadi. He is a former member of parliament.
Freddie Bayadi, sorry.
Welcome, sir, and happy Easter.
Thank you. Happy Easter
to everyone. Good morning, Dr. Bayadi, and happy Easter to you and your family. And if you could tell us, because we really appreciate you taking from your time and coming over on that very, very special day. So if you could elaborate on the importance of both Muslims and Christians celebrating that very special day. This has been happening for a long time. Easter is celebrated by every Egyptian.
Yeah.
You know, it's not only related to Christians or even not a final faction, I mean, a special faction of Christians. It's all Christians and Muslims. So how do you justify that phenomenon? Only in Egypt it happens.
I believe it's not only this celebration, but we used to get all the celebrations together, the religious celebrations and the national celebrations. We share them together. You can find even in the Christmas time, the Muslims are celebrating and congratulating others. And in Ramadan, the Christians, they go to the feast of Ramadan, and then Prophet Muhammad's birthday, they go and buy the special sweets. So it has been a long time and long history of celebrations, of Egyptian celebrations. This is why I say Happy Easter to all Egyptians, not only to Christians. And we are also, the next day of Easter is Sham al-Nasim, it's an Egyptian holiday, and has been a historical holiday since the pharaohs who started to celebrate this spring holiday. So it's all mixed together, the feelings of celebrations, and we feel happy for each other. If somebody is celebrating his feast or his holiday, we feel the happiness together, and we share, as we share the problems, we also share the joy and the happiness. And the Easter is a very special day to Christians, because actually it's the core of Christianity, the meaning of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the meaning of the idea of God being incarnated in human body and saving the world by the cross and the resurrection, when Jesus Christ rose from death after 3 days after his crucifixion. So this is the main concept of Christianity. That's why they call it the great feast or the great holiday. We celebrate two main celebration, the Christmas and the Christmas and the Easter. Of course, Easter is they call it the great day, because it carries the main concept of Christianity.
What are the preparations? Of course, it's one of the most important, as you said, celebrations for you. What are the preparations for this Easter? And it is, I believe, it is followed by another fasting, or you end your fasting now?
The Orthodox Church actually fasts 55 days before the Easter, and they end the fasting at the day of the Easter. So this is the longest continuous fasting period of the Orthodox Church.
Pope Theodorus II, the Pope of Alexandria, he conducted the mass celebrations, the festivities that was held at the Orthodox Church in the district of Abbasiyah. And of course, an array of high delegate officials and VIPs from all walks of life in Egypt, they attended the celebration. He delivered a very important speech, a very even emotional and precise message to the whole world. If you like to, as a politician also, if you would like to shed light on the importance of the Pope's speech, and what does that signify at that particular critical time in the region?
Actually, he's characterized by this kind of messages, very simple and to the point messages. And he's a very humble person. Yesterday we had a long talk with him. It was the Protestant Council of Churches delegates. I didn't attend the mass, but in the morning, because we had the Protestant church celebration at the same time.
Of course.
But in the morning, we went with a Protestant delegate to say Happy Easter to the Pope, and we had a long talk with him. And he opened his heart, and he talked how He used to be living in an area where he had no relatives in his village, and all his neighbors were Muslims, and they used to share the good times and the hard times together. So he actually is a very Egyptian person, and very loving person, very simple and humble person. And this is actually what characterizes most of his messages when he speaks from his heart to the people. Mm.
Mm. Is there a difference between Easter here in Egypt or and that from the West? Do you have any difference, or it's the same?
Actually, the timing is different. The Western calendar, they celebrate Easter in a different time, because we stick to the Eastern calendar and they stick to another calendar. So there's different timing of the celebration. But actually, it has the same meaning.
What are the rituals?
The rituals actually it varies from one country to another, mm-hmm. and the rituals mainly actually are not. I don't believe it's religious as much as it is social rituals. Like the way the Christian Egyptian celebrate their feasts, it's not any difference from the way that Muslim Egyptians celebrate their feasts. The way they go and they visit families and friends, and they exchange congratulations, and they eat together, go out together. So I believe the rituals and the things they used to do is more related to the community and to the social habits other than religious rituals.
Mm-hmm. I understand. I didn't want to waste that opportunity talking to a politician. I know this is a very special day. It's Easter. We're not supposed to talk politics, but I can't prevent myself because of in the light of what's happening in Aleppo, it is being interpreted or delivered to the world as it's like a war between Sunni and Shia. It's a tug of war between both sides. However, it's not. It's politics, mm-hmm. of course. So while we here Egyptians are witnessing that very beautiful scene of solidarity between all walks of life, Muslims and Christians and all factions of Christians celebrating in the Orthodox Church, like you said, you visited Pope Tadros II. So how do you read what's happening worldwide, and especially in the region with the sects, the rivalry sects, taking things that ugly way?
I've been in touch with some Syrian friends in the past few days, and especially in Aleppo, making sure how things are going there and how safe they are. Actually, the situation is very complicated there, and the media is usually taking one of two sides. They don't show all the situation, but like usual, yeah. What I got from my friends there and from following the situation, that actually it's not a matter of Sunni and Shia. It's a political fight between those who follow the official regime of al-Assad and those who are anti-regime. And Aleppo is actually divided into two main...
And those who are supported also financially by other superpowers.
Sure, and each group of them is supported by other countries too. Mm. And they are fighting together, and Aleppo is divided between the two groups. They are fighting together, and civilians are actually killed in the
and
middle.
And even Aleppo is excluded from the truce.
From
the truce that is being taken. I mean, the agreement of seizure of fire, Aleppo is excluded.
Yeah, it's divided
it's
now.
It's very sad.
It's divided between the two groups, and the problem with the civilians who are in the middle. Of course, the situation here in Egypt is much different, because we used to be one part. We never had a religious war, even if sometimes sectarian problems happen from time to another, but it's that kind of war. And we are, our nature as Egyptians, we tend to be more peaceful. Mm-hmm. Even when we had people who are going in demonstrations, you really find somebody carrying weapons. The problem of Aleppo, those who were against the regime,
they
were carrying weapons. It's a war. Mm-hmm. So this is what made it a bloody situation. Because you see people are protesting against the regime, and they are carrying weapons and fighting, and the regime is fighting them back. So it's a kind of war going on. Mm.
But we didn't find an official statement from Egypt regarding the situation in Syria, especially in Aleppo. We didn't find someone who's even condemning the situation there. Why is that?
I'm asking the same question with you. I believe we should have an official situation, an official statement about this. Mm-hmm. And Egypt as a leading country in the area. And you didn't find most of the Arab countries actually are staying silent about this.
Because
this
when the Paris attacks happened, the whole world, even the Arab world, were the top leaders of saying that they are against terrorism and this is not Islam.
Yeah.
What about that?
It's really a pity that you don't find an official or strong statement or action from the Arab countries. And those who are actually fighting in the ground, they are Arab people and supported by some Arab countries too. And this is really very very shameful situation for the Arab countries. Those who should be actually interfering for resolution of the situation, you find that the countries around are actually increasing the problem instead of interfering and having a way for resolution of them.
Mm-hmm. Right, Dr. Bayadi, it's amazing what we're going through. If someone here is observing what's happening in Egypt, Christians were celebrating resurrection and Easter, and Egyptians celebrating a very important festivity tomorrow, that is Easter, a pharaonic. Mm-hmm. Another pharaonic festivity. So we're celebrating everything together. Pharaonic, Christian, Muslim festivities and everything. And we are witnessing a state of solidarity that could not exist, that cannot exist in any other place. Do you think, comparing the situation in Egypt to what's happening in other parts of the region, like Yemen, for example, it's not different from Syria. There is also sectarian violence. Like in Iraq, the same thing. So, and Libya, it can be better. So do you think that Egypt was excluded just because of that very special state of solidarity, that culture that goes way back, that special case of culture that accepted the other is the only slogan for us, no matter what we go through, like you mentioned?
It's a big part of it. That's the only solution that saved Egypt. But this is, of course, one of the main reasons that saved Egyptians is the solidarity of the people. And we need to empower this more and emphasize it. And we don't have to deny that there are some other strange, fanatic ideas that actually started to be inside our community, and you find some people are calling not to congratulate Christians for the Easter, for example. Mm-hmm. You find some calls for this, though many people are actually fighting these calls back, and they are having counter arguments for this. Mm-hmm. But we couldn't hear this 20 years ago, so we should actually work more on the education. Because we can't take it for granted that we are all have solidarity and we have broad-minded people. But by time we find some fanatic ideas are going to be growing in the community.
Dr. So Freddy, actually we ran out of time. We want to thank you so much, Dr. Freddy El-Bayadi, former Member of Parliament, and happy Easter to you.
Thank you. Happy Easter to all Egyptians.
Thank you. Dina, it was a nice time.
My pleasure. Thank you very much, Dina Mamdouh, who was my partner. My name is Dina Hassim. Both Dinas are wishing you a very happy Easter, of course, after Dr. Freddy El-Bayadi, who honored us today on Easter Day in the studio. And may you have a very, very peaceful and blessed day. And until we meet you tomorrow, that's a goodbye from all of us.